Usually the other was 14, 12 pounds, but she grew it. And then we had my sister's her two boys who were
Can I convene to everybody again? Would you mind just taking about 3 or 4 seats over just a little bit, just so we may get some stragglers coming in, and it would be good just kind of scoot over just a little bit so we can leave a few open seats.
Oh,
open
that?
That's okay. We'll cover this broadcast.
So it doesn't get straight. Turn it so that we get. And record it so that we can share it later on, take snippets of it. So we just ran into a little bit of technical difficulty, and so we seem to have got that worked out. The other thing, so just a little housekeeping, there's a gym right here next to us. They drop weights occasionally. If you hear or feel like there's an earthquake, and it's not, well, it could be, but it probably isn't. It's just next door, so don't be too alarmed by that. The second is I just want to thank Devin and Lindy for opening up their store. So that we could have this opportunity to share with you some things that we're passionate about, and that hopefully you will find not only interesting, but helpful in improving your overall health. Now I'd like to introduce my co-presenter, who I'm very excited about. So, Roja, come on up. For those of you who know me from either being prior patient or having gone to Grayville Medical Group, you know I've now left, and we're opening a new integrated medical center here in Temecula called the Temecula Center for Integrated Medicine. And I'm just super, super lucky and happy to have a physician of Roja's caliber joining me all the way from Florida. She heard about it. No, I'm just kidding. It just so happened that the stars were aligned. We had met a few years ago at a conference, and we reconnected, and she told me she was moving to California without a job. And I told her I could fix that really quickly. And so she's going to be working with us part-time, and she's trained in functional medicine and integrative medicine, and we're really excited to have her there. So she's going to be helping me with the presentation tonight, but she has the unique experience of doing her medical school training in India. So her parents were born and raised and immigrated to the United States. And please correct me if I get any of this wrong. But Roja was born here and grew up in Florida. When the opportunity came to go to medical school, her parents really encouraged her to go back to their native home in India. And she, a little bit begrudgingly, accepted that invitation and went back and had a marvelous experience. So not only does she bring her Western conventional trained residency, she also has that experience of having been trained in a medical school outside the United States to bring some of that cultural and experience with her. So we're really excited about that aspect as well. So she's going to be participating on just a little bit. Now you need to come forward just a little bit more because you haven't shown up on the camera. And everybody who's watching is going to wonder, you know, who you are. So you know, you're welcome to sit if you want, or you can go in the back, whatever you feel. All right, great. So some of you have been to, I think this is now the third talk I've done here at So Good Gluten Free. And so some of this will be a little bit of a review, and for some of you it will be brand new. Some of you are probably hyper-educated in gluten and gluten intolerance and celiac disease, and some of you may be coming and just learning for the first time. So because of that, or the broad range of individuals, we're gonna kind of cover a lot. But the main focus tonight really is, you know, what's the deal with gluten? You know, what, is it just a fad? Is this just another diet that, you know, you can lose weight on? Or is there something really to it that is making all of us, or contributing to making all of us a little sick, not feeling at our optimal best? And so that's what we're going to explore tonight. And Roja found this great video on the internet. And so some of you may have seen this already. And some of you may not. So we're gonna start with this.
People are very interested in food nowadays. People don't even cook, watch cooking shows. Everyone has an opinion on what you should or shouldn't be putting into your body. Lately, this is here in LA, but people are very anti-gluten, which bothers me because I'm very pro-pizza. You can't live on pizza and anti-gluten. So now, some people can't eat gluten for medical reasons, which that I get. It annoys me, but I get it. But a lot of people here don't eat gluten because, like, someone in their yoga class told them not to. I keep asking people about this, and I started to wonder, how many of these people even know what gluten is? So we decided to find out. Gluten, in case you didn't know, and I didn't know this, is a mixture of two proteins found in wheat and some other natural grains. But here in LA, it's comparable to Satanism. So we sent a camera crew out to a popular exercise spot right up the street from us to ask people who are gluten-free a simple question. What is gluten? What is this thing you will not eat? So we're going to meet a person who doesn't eat gluten. Together, we're going to guess if they know what gluten is. Are you ready? Yeah! Now, what else do you have?
Do you maintain a gluten-free diet?
I do indeed.
And what is gluten?
Okay. Gluten is. Everyone says no.
Well, as far as for me, how it affects my body.
But what is gluten?
This is pretty sad because I don't know.
Yeah. You maintain a gluten-free diet. What is gluten?
All right, does this shirtless gentleman know it? Yes, okay.
Gluten's in bread. It's a flour derivative wheat. You know that?
It's a flour.
It's like bread. It's like that pastries.
It's in those things.
Yeah, it's in those things.
So what is it exactly?
Gluten is it's like a grain, right?
I like when he...
So is everyone in LA like pop limit? They just go around without wearing shirts on. It's kind of funny that nobody has.
He coughed. He's like, sorry, I have some in my throat. Excuse
me. You mentioned a gluten-free diet?
Yeah, I tried to the best of my ability, yeah.
What is gluten?
Does she know what gluten is?
It's the wheat and products such as like bread or pastas, rice.
Why do you avoid it?
I mention that. I mean, I haven't researched it to the fullest. I have a girlfriend from Russia. She actually just got me into it, so she's reading a book about it.
Oh, okay. Russians know about Gluten and Putin. They know about both of them.
You maintain a gluten-free diet?
I do. I actually don't eat rye, wheat, oat, bran, dairy, nuts, or eggs.
Wow. What is gluten?
Does Jewish John Hamm know what gluten is?
It is a part, I believe, of the wheat that I really don't know.
All right. So, how many in here know what gluten is? All right. So, gluten is a protein found in wheat as well as other grains. It's not the only grain that contains wheat or contains gluten. All right, but it is a protein, and believe it or not, we can't digest it. So in order to digest proteins, you need something called an enzyme. An enzyme is a protein that your body produces. It's like scissors, all right? And it gets in there. And in order to digest proteins, you have to break them down into amino acids, which are the building blocks of protein, and you've got to be able to cut those down. We don't have the tools, really, to cut down gluten. So really, most of us just kind of poop it out unless it attaches. And that's when it starts to cause problems. Now, there are a few people that can actually digest gluten a little bit. And if you take enzymes that help you digest gluten, that actually will help break it down and you can get some protein out of that. Where gluten really does its damage is once it gets through the intestinal wall. That then becomes a problem. And so that's why it's causing so many problems, is because gluten is a foreign protein to the body. So we don't need gluten. We love gluten. Why? Because gluten allows the bread, the doughs from these grain products to become very sticky and they rise beautifully. And so that really helps in baking. And so we love gluten. It makes the bread smell better. We like that protein. Now, when it gets denatured in the cooking process, then it breaks it down a little bit, and we may get a little bit of that digested. But for the most part, its purpose really is in the German nation of the seed. So when wheat is sprouted, then gluten serves as a protein in the germination process. And so if you sprout grains that have gluten in them, you decrease the gluten load. So here's the other problem, is that modern wheat is a lot different than ancient wheat, and even wheat up until about 50 or 60 years ago. So part of the problem is this new modern wheat has been changed. And it was changed because of the hunger problems that we have in the world. And we thought, wow, and this wasn't a bad idea, but we thought, wow, if we could create a wheat that would have a higher capacity to have, so that it contained more carbohydrates, more nutrients, and we could produce more of it on a smaller amount of acreage, then we could send that to the world, and that would be helpful. And so that's what happened. They started hybridizing. They didn't genetically modify it. They hybridized the wheat until they got what we call dwarf wheat, which only stands about 18 inches tall and has to be protected. It does not, if you were to try and plant dwarf wheat out in the wild, it would die. It would get overrun, and it doesn't have much of an immune system. It has to be protected. But it's great for making lots and lots of crops that you can produce wheat and then send it all over the world and feed people. The problem is that when you start to look at the genetic components, even though it's not genetically modified, ancient wheat, which is the first one that our grandparents and great-grandparents used, is called emmer wheat. And that's what they had mostly in Europe up until even just a few years ago, was the farro wheat that you get in Italy, the farro wheat. That is this emmer wheat. It only has 28 chromosomes. Well, the modern dwarf wheat has 42 chromosomes. And the more ancient wheat than that, called einkorn wheat, only has 14 chromosomes. Anyone ever had einkorn wheat? You're related to me, so you don't care. So one other person. All right, but yeah, you can actually, it almost disappeared completely, but now you can buy einkorn wheat pasta, einkorn wheat bread. It's heavy. It does not have a lot of gluten in it. All right, so the other problem is that even if it's organic wheat, doesn't matter. Right, it's the genetic changes in the wheat and the increased gluten load. This dwarf wheat is heavy. It's concentrated. And that creates a problem as well. The last thing that's really interesting is that they've discovered a new gene all entirely in this modern wheat that didn't exist before. This Glia Alpha 9. And they're finding that it's creating some of the problems as well. So what are some of the issues here? So in looking at it, there's basically three types of gluten intolerance. There's gluten sensitivity, there's a wheat allergy, and then there's celiac disease. All right, the difference between the three of them is a gluten sensitivity is when you react immunologically, meaning your body produces antibodies against it, but it's not, it may not destroy the gut. Celiac disease is really when it destroys the gut. The fine layer of the gut called the microvilli starts to get broken down and basically gets stripped off, which is why in most adults, when they have celiac disease, diarrhea is the presenting complaint when they finally get diagnosed. Because they can't digest very well because all these finger-like projections have been broken off and it gets washed out. Where gluten sensitivity may just be that your body's reacting to the gluten protein and now attacking other parts of your body. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. So you may have other symptoms that may or may not be gut-related. And then a wheat allergy is an IgE reaction. So those are people who, you know, have asthma or may have, as soon as they smell wheat, they start to react. People have peanut allergies or soy allergies where they react with breathing, swelling, you know, rashes immediately. That immediate reaction, that's an IgE, that's an allergy. Okay, so we have celiac disease, which is an autoimmune disorder, an allergy, and then a sensitivity, which still, they all involve the immune system, but in different ways, okay? Now, some of the symptoms associated with gluten intolerance come across the board. So I've had patients with gluten intolerance present with headaches, with depressions, with stomach aches, with sometimes I'm tired, I'm fatigued, I don't have any energy. And that could be there when we start looking, we find that that's one of the problems. We start seeing antibodies. It affects estrogen metabolism. And so may see problems with some of the estrogen dominance situations. So it can affect that as well. So, but what is the prevalence of celiac disease? Is it real common? Well, you know, interestingly enough, we have seen a significant increase in celiac disease since they introduced modern wheat. Now, about a third of the population or more carry the genetics so that you could have the predisposition for developing celiac disease. But only a small portion, about 10% of those, of the third, will actually start to have symptoms associated with celiac disease. Only 1% of those will actually develop celiac disease. So we're talking about a small percentage. But it used to be that it was about 1 in 2 or 3,000, and now it's 1 in 100, almost 2 in 100, 1.8% now of Americans have celiac disease. That's a huge increase, all right? That, along with other things that have continued. So here's just kind of how they overlap, okay? So this is, you got celiac disease on one side, and you have gluten sensitivity on the other. And what you find is that the similarities, the things that cross over, are you're going to get inflammation in the gut. You're going to have a response to the gliadin part of the gluten protein from the immune system, and you're going to get increased white blood cells called neutrophils in the area where the gluten protein is starting to attack. But again, what you don't have is an autoimmune against the tissue transglutaminase in the gut, and you're going to find that you have increased epithelial barrier function. So with gluten sensitivity, the little epithelium, this structure that throughout our entire body, that structure starts to change. It gets thick, but in getting thicker, it actually loses. We start to see leakiness, not just in the gut, but in the blood vessels and in the brain. And that becomes a big problem. So when we look at the last, one of the ways that we can tell the difference, all right, is this. The looking at these different antibodies. So the endomycial antibody, IgA, is going to be positive in 90% of all celiac patients, but negative in people who have gluten sensitivity. Now, when they just looked at controls, people who weren't having any symptoms at all, they found that they were negative. And these were people who didn't. And so really the diagnosis of gluten sensitivity, you may have symptoms, but really it's a laboratory diagnosis, as is celiac disease. In fact, the definitive way of determining celiac disease is a biopsy of the small intestine in the ileum. You have to get a colonoscopy. So the only way that really you can be, people may tell you, or doctors may say it's likely that you have celiac disease, or, you know, I'm pretty sure you have celiac disease, but really the only definitive way is to get biopsy-proven celiac disease in the standard of care within medicine. Now, does that mean that if you have positive endomycial antibodies, that we're going to say you don't have celiac disease? Probably not, because the likelihood is that there's just not enough damage, or maybe where they biopsy just didn't happen to have enough damage, so I'm not going to throw that out there. But you can see that the tissue transglutaminase IgA and the endomycial antibody IgA are both positive in celiac disease in most cases. Now, immunoglobulin A, or IgA, is only found in the intestine and the gut. So, it's produced in the mouth and in the gut. You'll find it in the blood, because this is a blood test. But it's a secretory immunoglobulin. So it's going to be attacking things in the digestive system for the most part. You'll also find it in the lungs and in the respiratory tract, because there's secretory lymph tissue and immune tissue there as well. But for the most part, it's not going to be found inside the blood and inside the body, except for when it breaks through and the levels get high. So finding it in the blood is a bad thing. That means it's really, really high, and that the barrier is starting to break down, and you're getting leaking of those immunoglobulins into the blood. But the blood immunoglobulins are going to be IgG and IgE. Okay, so those are the ones that are going to be there. So we'll talk more about the leaky gut. But yeah, when we're talking about leaking in there, yeah, that's going to be the leaky gut. All right, and then I'm going to let Rose is going to talk a little bit more about that when she goes over autoimmune disorders, so we'll get to that later. And then the last thing is that, you know, so we can also test for the genetics of it. Can you see okay from there? You're welcome to, if you want to sit here and you can sign to her there, would that work? You can see my. Okay. We've been going for a little bit, but this is all stuff she got the last time she did for the most part, so she hasn't missed much. Well, she won't be able to see this. Okay, she's just kidding. Okay, all right. Okay, we're back. Sorry. All right, so there's a genetic test that we can do now to determine the likelihood you could develop celiac disease. So when I said before, a third of people will have the genetic predisposition, we can actually test for that. It's the HLA, or human leukocyte antigen, DQ2 and DQ8. All right, and depending upon whether you have those mutations, but at most Northern Europeans have that mutation. All right, we are not good at processing wheat. Okay, so if you have that and it's positive, the likelihood is that you will end up with either gluten intolerance or celiac. So, poor Goldilocks, in the modern era, the porridge was made with wheat. So then, how do we get this leaky gut, okay, or intestinal dysfunction? All right. So there's many ways that we can get it. We can end up with increased bacterial overgrowth, and then too much of one type of a bacteria or pathogenic bacteria can start to cause problems. We can, if we're stressed, the cortisol levels will start to shift and change the way that the bacteria in the gut will be functioning. And that can lead to a breakdown of the gut. And then there's insults. So anything that's going to cause inflammation in the gut can also lead to a breakdown of the gut membrane or bacteria. And gluten, actually, the more gluten load you have on the gut, the more it will start to break down, because everybody has an inflammatory response to gluten. Everybody. There's not a human on this planet that won't have an inflammatory reaction to gluten. And as I like to say, if you have a good fire department, you're going to be okay. You'll put out the fire, and that'll be all right. But the problem is now when you start getting more than one fire, that fire department is only so good, and you're going to start having problems with tolerating gluten. So that's why somebody in their 60s may develop a gluten intolerance or sensitivity. And you're like, why now all of a sudden? Well, part of it's the change in the modern wheat. The other part of it is that now finally he's had too many fires in his gut, and that's going to be a problem. One of the things that is crazy about this is that the average American consumes 147 pounds of flour a year. Okay? Now, you know there are people that do more than that, because I'm not consuming 147 pounds. And when you look at sugar, they're consuming 170 pounds of sugar per person per year. Those two things alone are the two most inflammatory agents that we have, and we're up, well, almost over 300 pounds of inflammatory food on a yearly basis. That's going to create a leaky gut. So how does this work? All right, so what happens is that you start to get this breakdown, and we found that gluten in particular, it causes a breakdown of the zonulin molecule, which is basically this adhesive molecule. And Scientific American put out a great article on this, and this is where this illustration came from. So if you want to go learn more about Alessio Fasano's work, this is what he discovered. This is what finally gave some credence to the whole leaky gut theory. And now, even conventional doctors are starting, which is called intestinal permeability, are talking about this and the leaky gut, because we're seeing that this is a cause of not just celiac disease, but lots and lots of problems. And so when we get there, then what's happening with autoimmune disorders is that there's three components that need to happen. You need to have the right genes, you need to have a leaky gut, and you need to have some kind of trigger. So what would that trigger be, or what could be leading to that? All right, how many of you like horror films? Okay, not okay, well then, you may want to cover your eyes and your ears for this next part, because when we talk about genetically modified foods, it's horrific, okay? So for starters, all right, there's 80,000 pounds of chemicals being produced on a daily basis in our country, all right? And that doesn't include pesticides. It doesn't include GMOs. And so all of these chemicals are being produced on a daily basis. When we get into pesticides, there's over 1 billion pounds of Roundup sprayed on our crops last year. And I'm going to tell you what Roundup does. And it's not pretty. Okay? So basically, in order for a plant to become genetically modified, what they do is they take the virus or the bacteria, and they mix it with whatever organism can produce this insecticide or herbicide. And then they get that virus to infect the organism, transposition the gene, and then they take that gene and put it into the plant seed. And so then now the seed of the plant has that section of the gene that produces that pesticide or herbicide in its genetic makeup. So now that plant becomes a pesticide or herbicide producing plant. Now, when something is going to kill, the way that the Roundup works, all right, is that it does two things. One is it gets into the mitochondria. The mitochondria is the energy producing part of your cell, and it destroys the mitochondria. You can't produce energy, you're not going to do very well. The second thing that it does is that it kills bacteria. So if you're an insect and you've got, now, I don't know if you know this, but we've got 3 pounds of bacteria in our gut, so we should. If you have overgrowth, you're going to have more. If you have not enough, you're not going to have that. But if you have about 3 pounds of bacteria. If you have more DNA in your gut than you do in your entire body. If you have more foreign DNA in you than you have your own DNA. Okay, so what Roundup does is it kills the good bacteria. But the bad bacteria, like the Clostridium species, which causes botulism, C. difficile, colitis, that doesn't get killed off. So then those bacteria, and then it starts to create this leaky gut, and so then these bacteria get in, they kill the insect. So that's what's in our plant. Now guess what? A mitochondria is a mitochondria, okay? Roundup or glyphosate, which is the ingredient in Roundup that does the damage, is going to affect your mitochondria the same way it did to the bacteria in the insect. What's the difference is you have billions and trillions and gazillions of mitochondria. So you may be able to tolerate some of that before you start having significant symptoms, but later on it's going to be problematic. So if this is killing the good bacteria in your gut and allowing the bad bacteria to grow, now you just set yourself up for having leaky guts. All right, so GMOs combined with gluten, really bad mix. All right, the other one that is really prevalent is BT. All right, BT is called a crytoxin. Why? Because it's like a sharp crystal that just cuts through the gut. So it's one that just actually tears through the gut. Alright? Over 85% of the corn in this country is genetically modified with BT. Okay? The BT then punches holes in the gut, and then the body's own natural bacteria, which should be okay, not natural, but the good bacteria then get in the bloodstream, and it's not supposed to be in the bloodstream, and then it kills with the hooks. Okay, that's a real big problem as well. So BT, what they found was that it was increasing the allergies and components of those the farmers and migrant workers that were working on fields being sprayed. So they thought, well, great, if we put it in the corn, then we won't have to spray as much. Well, guess what? The plant produces 1,000 times more BT than you get if you spray it. Your exposure increases that much. That's pretty scary. All right? About the only crop of corn that is protected from that is the corn on the cob. Any process, you buy chips, you buy anything that has corn syrup in it, you buy tortillas, then for the most part, all of them, unless it says organic, it's going to have that BT toxin. Okay? And that's bad news. Now, here's an interesting study they did in Canada. Now, Canadians aren't big taco eaters. They're not eating a lot of corn chips. But when they tested their pregnant women in this particular study, 93% of them had BT toxin in their blood. And 80% of the unborn fetuses had it in their blood. Now, the researchers all said, Oh yeah, no. Even if the plant produces it and you swallow it, it gets in the gut and the acid's going to kill it, denature it. It's going to be done. It's not going to be a problem. How did they get it in their blood? Well, it's been hypothesized that the bacteria in the gut are getting that genetic translocation in their gene, and now they're producing it in the gut. So when you're eating GMO foods, remember, you're eating the DNA, not just the protein and the carbohydrates and the fat. You're eating the DNA as well, and that DNA is going to get incorporated into you. So we don't have definitive studies as to where this BT is coming yet, but that's pretty alarming. That's pretty scary. 2012, Beer Makers of America had to send back all the barley. They said, you are literally killing us, because all of the yeast that they were using to try the brewer's yeast to get the fermentation of the barley all died. With the Roundup Ready barley that they got. So, what do you do? You gotta buy organic, all right? The big four are soy, corn, canola, and cotton. But even meats, all right, if that cow is eating corn, which most cows are fed corn in this country, and it's not non-GMO organic corn that they're feeding, because that's expensive, they're getting GMO corn, they're getting it into them, and they actually have had cows die because of the BT toxin. Now, if you want to learn more about this, there's a great documentary movie called Genetic Roulette, produced by Jeffrey Smith, who is the expert. The interesting thing is in Europe, GMOs are banned, but not here. And if you didn't know this, the current czar over biotechnology is the former lawyer for Monsanto. Now, I'm not going to get political. You can vote however you want, but that's why you'd want to know that information. All right, so we need to free the gluten. Does that make you a cereal killer? So what then are some of the medical problems associated with it? What are we seeing as a cause, whether it's directly related or indirectly related? Interesting. So did you guys hear that? So what she's saying is that, so in Europe, because the livestock is being fed, they won't let the humans eat the genetically modified corn, but they're giving it to the livestock because it's so much cheaper. So they're eating the meat that's not organic because they're getting the genetically modified corn, and because of that, now the humans are starting to get sick. And it's coming from here. But there are countries now that are refusing the food. So this whole reason of hybridizing the wheat and coming up with genetically modified crops so that we could produce more to feed the world is now starting to backfire. Because these countries literally are saying, do not come in here with your genetically modified crops. So here's a list of things. I'm gonna briefly hit some of these later on, but Roger's gonna come up and talk about autoimmune disorders and how gluten plays a substantial role in autoimmune disorder. And it's coming from here.
Okay, and thank you everyone for coming, and Devin and Lindy for hosting this wonderful event. Can everyone hear me? No. All right, I will try to talk louder. Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, just out of curiosity, this is just out of my own personal curiosity, how many of you are gluten-free? Okay. How many of you came to learn about gluten because you've heard a lot about it and you just want to see how this plays a role in your health? All right. All right, well, I'm going to focus on autoimmune disease because I think it's a really hot topic, and I don't think that there is a lot of information out there on autoimmune diseases. So these are basically the topics that I'm going to cover. So we're going to talk about the immune system and why it is so important. We're going to define what does it mean to have an autoimmune disease. We're going to talk about the incidence, prevalence, and all the unique statistics that you're going to be very surprised about when it comes to autoimmune diseases. We'll also talk about how we trigger our immune system to malfunction, and how gluten triggers our immune system to act against us. And we'll talk about traditional medicine and how our approach is in treating autoimmune diseases, and how we're actually not really treating the problem, and we're probably making it a lot worse. And we'll talk about how we can build up our immune system and all these different factors that play a role in strengthening our immune system that we may not be aware of, and they're things that we do every single day that affect our immune system. So our immune system is critical for life. It works 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. It identifies harmful bacteria, viruses, parasites, fungi. It identifies precancerous cells and cancerous cells and destroys them so that they don't grow, they don't proliferate, and they don't create disease. So it's absolutely essential. I don't know if any of you have seen the movie The Bubble Boy. I think there was an old movie back in the day, and then they made a newer one. And if he breathed the air, he would die. And that is how essential our immune system is, and I feel like it doesn't get enough credit. So what is an autoimmune disease? So an autoimmune disease is an illness that occurs when our immune system wrongfully attacks and destroys our own healthy tissue. So that is an autoimmune disease. This is just a cartoon. I've inserted some cartoons because it's just kind of a heavy topic. So I always get to laugh in between, so feel free to laugh out loud. So this is not something to brag about, really. So something that you might find surprising is that autoimmune diseases are the third leading cause of morbidity and mortality in our industrialized nation. That should be shocking. It's preceded only by cardiac disease and cancer. So it's a big deal. Here's some more shocking statistics. So the National Institute of Health estimates that approximately 24 million Americans have some form of an autoimmune disease. And when you compare that to heart disease, for instance, 22 million people are affected, and when you compare it to cancer, 9 million people are affected. But in reality, when they came up with this estimate of 24 million, they were only measuring 24 diseases for which they had epidemiological studies for. So actually, in reality, the estimate is probably closer to 50 million, which is very significant. So how much is this costing us in terms of healthcare costs? Annually, in terms of treating autoimmune disease, we spend about $100 billion. And when you compare that to cancer, it's about half that, so it's $57 billion. And then combined, when you look at the health impact and the cost of heart disease and strokes, it's actually $200 billion. So you can see how that's quite lopsided. Another funny question, so I'm afraid neither your insurance nor your immune system will cover it. Let's hope that none of us are in that situation. So here's some more shocking statistics. So the NIH, in 2003, they funded research for autoimmune disease, and they contributed $591 million. And again, when you compare that to cancer, we spend about $6.1 billion, and in stroke, $2.4 billion on research. And another shocking fact is that autoimmune disease is one of the top 10 leading causes of death in both female children and women of all ages up to 64 years. So there's greater than 80 overall different types of autoimmune diseases, actually closer to 100, probably way more than that. The most common I listed here, we have childhood asthma, rheumatoid arthritis, type 1 diabetes, celiac disease, autoimmune thyroiditis, which there are various kinds, inflammatory bowel disease, which includes ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease, lupus, multiple sclerosis, psoriasis. I really could go on and on, and if we touch base on all of this, we'd be here forever. It's crazy. So really the question is, how separate are all these different disease entities? So when it comes to autoimmune diseases, it can be very challenging both as a practitioner and a patient. Because when we develop symptoms, this happens very slowly, just like with chronic disease, it happens so slowly over a period of time. And initially, we don't really have too many symptoms. We just feel tired or achy, and things that we generally don't complain about. It's not like I can compare my energy levels with someone else. I just think, oh, this is how everyone feels. You don't really know how crummy you're feeling. When you go to your practitioner and you explain this, there's so much overlap between all these different autoimmune processes that it can be really challenging to distinguish one from the other. And insurance companies, trying to find what tests to run and all this stuff, you can really kind of just get very frustrated as patients and as practitioners. So it's important to understand that as well. And so something that I like to tell my patients, when it comes to all disease processing, you really want to simplify things. The root cause of all disease processing is inflammation. So if I could wrap around this room, and if I had a magic wand and I could wave it in front of all of you and zap all of the inflammation out of all of you, head to toe, take away all of it, you would all be out of here and feel fantastic. You would love me. I would be rich. I have to end all cure all of you. Amazing. It really would. So if we really simplify things and we simplify health, we can say that the root cause really is inflammation. So what triggers immune dysfunction? What causes it to all of a sudden attack our own healthy tissues? Well, just like everything else, I wish there was a one-stop-shop answer for this, but there's always medicine. There's an overlap. Everyone's unique. Every single person is unique. And that's why we need to really personalize medicine. And there can be a little bit of this, a little bit of that. You really have to delve in deep and figure out the story. So there's different things that can activate our immune system. First is our nutrition, our diet, so important. Our food intake is so critical to our health. And, the standard American diet is a terrible diet. It's a diet that promotes inflammation in the body, and it contributes to activating the immune system. Our lifestyle, we all live stressful lifestyles, we're always spread thin, we're running from here to there. Are we getting enough sleep? How are we handling our stress? All of these things affect our immune system. When we sleep, that's when our body heals and it regenerates. And when we're sleep deprived, our immune system takes a hit because of it. So it's important to realize all of these different factors. Dr. Lundquist talked about leaky gut, which 80% of our immune system is in our digestive system. So if we have a leaky gut, that's a huge problem. We're going to talk a little bit more about that in a little bit. Our toxic flows, all these things that we're exposed to. It's amazing, all the different toxins each person is exposed to on a given day. These are the things that we really need to pay attention to. So when our immune system is activated, it in turn triggers off all of these different reactions. And so we get oxidative stress, we get tissue injury, we get the release of all these toxic mediators that are just all this inflammation is taking place from head to toe and targeting all the different organs in our body. So here's a good illustration of foods which counteract and alleviate inflammation and foods that promote inflammation. So on the left, we have all the anti-inflammatory foods that we always want to incorporate into our diet on a daily basis. So we've got green leafy veggies, we've got nuts and seeds, we've got healthy oils, polyunsaturated, monounsaturated fats, we've got lots of colors in terms of fruits and vegetables, we've got onions and garlic, turmeric and ginger, which are potent anti-inflammatory. And then unfortunately on the right side, because of all this fancy marketing, we've somehow steered into this really bad situation where we're eating foods that are making us sick. And so these foods that promote inflammation include gluten, which we're talking about today, casein, saturated fats, trans fats, fried foods, refined sugars, soda, and then of course fast food, you know, convenience foods. And these are the foods that are promoting inflammation in our body, they're activating our immune system, and they're making us sick. So it's very important to understand how food is medicine, but it's choosing the right foods. And these are choices that we make every single day that really don't pay as much attention as we need to. And so there's two ends of the paradigm. Foods can either be healing or they can cause disease. And that's important to understand. So when you really think about gluten sensitivity, it is. It's an autoimmune process. So what happens is none of us, whether we have celiac disease, whether we have the gene for celiac disease, none of us digest gluten. Our body, our immune system identifies it as a foreign protein. So when we consume it, when it hits our digestive tract, there is all kinds of inflammation. It's like a fire that goes off instantly. And so the lining of our digestive system, the mucosa, becomes inflamed. And so if we could see it, we would be doing a lot more about it. Like, for instance, if we have a cut on our hand, we can see that it's irritated, that it's inflamed, but we can't see inside of our digestive system. And so it's much harder to connect the two together. And so when we get this repeated impact of these inflammatory foods, like gluten, then the mucosa becomes, we have these tight junctions in the mucosa, and so it becomes compromised and we get leaking. So those tight cellular junctions basically develop holes, and then we get leakage of all these foreign proteins, all these antigens, and all this large food particles that we usually not get into the bloodstream, and then that triggers off an immune response. And then all of a sudden we've got inflammation charging through our bloodstream, making us feel sick. So it's important to understand that.
Is that why it can manifest itself in other ways, like your shoulders or headaches or, you know, all over the body? Sometimes we can sometimes think that, well, I won't feel sick in my gut, like I'm not having diarrhea, so I don't have a problem, but that's, I guess, why it can manifest itself.
Yes, it's amazing, and I can tell you so many stories about patients. Who didn't realize how lousy they were feeling. They thought it was normal. They just had, like, all this joint pain. They kind of felt achy. They just felt tired, and they just, you know, drink coffee and forge through it. And we have so much going on in life that it's easy to just push it back. You don't really pay attention because, again, it's cooling. It happens so slowly that you forget what it feels like to feel normal. So this is a cartoon that really illustrates you know, all the characteristics of inflammation. So we've got heat, we've got swelling, redness, pain, and eventually loss of function. And these are all the signs of inflammation that are charging through our bloodstream and affecting all of our organs. So again, this just tells us again how, you know, our food affects our immune function and in our inflammatory status, and how it is clinically and pathologically significant.
Number of studies it's really key because of all parallel studies in the
nutrition is something that is very hard to study. And I'll have to look at it. I'm just going to tell you
there are plenty of studies that are being done in Europe and here in America. In fact, Italy and Netherlands, some great studies on gluten sensitivity and what's going on. So there's a lot. There is so much out there right now in regards to this. It's just exploding. exploding right now.
And my
The standard American diet has been shown over and over again to be horrific. I mean, it is pro-inflammatory, and it is the reason why, despite spending more than any other country on health care, we rank 37th. And we will continue to spend more and more on healthcare because we're not getting it. As long as we have subsidized food that's genetically modified and is being fed to our livestock and we're not doing anything about it, we're going to continue to be sick. I tell my kids all the time, as long as McDonald's is in business, I will be in business.
Yeah. It's true, actually. In China, where they used to have a really great diet, now everyone is commuting to the city, they don't have time to cook, and the art of cooking is being lost, and it's all fast food there, and they're developing the chronic diseases that we have here in America. They're seeing obesity, hypertension, diabetes, growing, and we're the ones that have passed that on. We're spreading around the world, and we shouldn't be proud of that. It's very sad. We really need to start really going back to our roots and start thinking about our lifestyle and what's important. So I heard an interesting fact about McDonald's. I was just at a conference a couple of weeks ago, and the McDonald's French fries, and the smell even, oh my gosh. But they are so particular about the type of potato that they use. They use only one particular type of potato because of the length. You get that nice, spray in the potato. It's very appealing to the eye. But basically, they spray it with a very potent neurotoxic pesticide to keep it from getting any brown spots. They don't want any brown spots at all. And when the farmers spray, I mean, they have to put on some heavy-duty gear just to protect themselves from this chemical. We're allowed to eat it and understand how that's happening. So it's terrible. It's really sad. We really hear the foods that we're consuming and the harm that it's doing to our health and to our society.
So
in my
horror movie,
sure.
Beware. At least I gave you a warning,
all right? So another cartoon here. So it's not easy, It's not easy making changes. Food is it's what brings us all together, and we develop habits, and there is a lot to do, and there's not enough time in the day. Sometimes as a practitioner, when I'm trying to sell the idea of food might be making me sick, and even just kind of, rub up my patients, maybe let's take it out for 6 weeks. Let's see what happens. It can be really devastating, and I understand that. But this is kind of, it takes along on that how, he doesn't realize this will be the end of my longest committed relationship. It can be really devastating, and I understand that. So again, this slide here highlights again how we consume a pro-inflammatory diet. Gluten, again, not be digested by anyone. And when we do consume it, it creates a fermentable carbohydrate, actually, which feeds bacteria in our gut, and it can lead to a condition called small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, which is a growing entity now and a problem and difficult to treat. It can cause all kinds of reactions. And again, how we talked about gluten is identified as a foreign protein. So when it leaks through those gaps in our intestines, the leaky gut and gets into our bloodstream, activating our immune system and firing up this whole fire, making us sick. I mean, gluten makes us sick in a lot of ways. So it depends on consumption in a lot of ways. And sometimes how many hits are we getting? Some people are doing great, have no problems, but maybe they go through a really bad time in their lives where they're going through a lot of psychological stress. Maybe someone in the family was sick, and then all of a sudden they find themselves just sick. So it's just multiple impacts and things slowly become to evolve and make sense. Yeah. So when you have such a strong immune reaction, it's a huge stress on your body. And
is you're stimulating all of these stress hormones to be released in your body. And so that causes, when your body's in a stressed state, your blood pressure goes up. And then as far as, you know, inflammation in the joints, when you have inflammation going on, you retain fluid. I had one patient, which is a really great example. She was in, she's in her 40s, and she came to see me for the first time. And typically, she was healthy. She had two young kids. She was a stay-at-home. She was a stay-at-home mom. She would go and see her gynecologist once a year just to get her pelvic exam, and her pap smear, doing her due diligence. And her gynecologist would get her annual labs. And that year, coincidentally, her cholesterol was just a little bit high, so they felt uncomfortable, and they said, I think you need to establish with a primary care physician. So she came to see me. And then when she came to see me, she's like, oh, I'm here, I might as well just tell you everything. So she told me everything was going on, and she felt bad because she felt like she was whining after she started talking. She's like, this is achy, that's achy, I feel tired all the time, I eat well, I exercise, I'm not losing weight around my belly, I just don't understand. And she laughed because she said she felt like she was just whining. But when I listened to her, and in fact, I didn't even have her labs in front of me, and I hate ordering labs again, so I said, you know what I'll do I listened to her story, and I strongly felt that she had gluten sensitivity, and she also had a dairy sensitivity. So we talked about that, and I sold the idea to her. She was such a champ, and she said she was depressed the first day. She was like, how am I going to do this? This is a lot. And then she's like, she was such a champ, and she said, you know what? I'm either going to do this all the way, or I'm not going to do it at all. And so she did it, and I got her labs, and she came back 4 weeks later. It was between 4 and 6 weeks later, and it was amazing. All of her symptoms were away, and it was the biggest thing that she told me was that her shoe size, she was so inflamed that her shoe size went down 2 full sizes.
Oh.
That's how inflamed she was. I mean, these things, like, this is like magic. And that's what the food is doing to her. She's sure. And I can tell you lots of stories like that, which are inspiring for those who are taking on the challenge for themselves. But it's just important to know what a huge impact this really is having on your health. So, we talked about the grains with simple carbohydrates. I mean, we're consuming so many refined sugars, and every time we have a big load of refined sugars, for the next 2 to 4 hours, our immune system is suppressed with toxins. And we're triggering off inflammation, a whole inflammatory response, just by having that cupcake or Snickers bar or whatever it was. So this is a great workflow here that tells us about how the whole leaky gut symptom occurs. So a great illustration in that regard. So we have these allergenic foods like gluten, which we consume. It causes a fire in our intestines. It causes all this inflammation in the lining of our intestines. And then finally, those junctions start to break, we develop holes in there, and then we get those antigens, like gluten, which are released into the bloodstream. They trigger off our immune system, then we've got all this inflammation, and pretty soon your body starts backfiring, and it starts to attack your own healthy tissue, because it's just a trigger, all this fire. So, here's another great illustration. I still love you. It's hard to let go, and I understand that. Even though you apparently make people feel irritable, fatigued, short, hyperactive, forgetful, depressed, anxious, sleepless, and almost dead, I still love you. So, this is what's very disheartening and why it's important that we approach medicine in a different way. So conventional or traditional medicine, when we treat autoimmune diseases, basically it's all this inflammation that's going on. So we treat symptoms. And so how do we get rid of inflammation? We hit them with the strongest anti-inflammatory. We're bringing out the big guns, the strongest anti-inflammatory we can find. Those are steroids. And has anyone ever been on steroids before? people who have been on it repeatedly will call it the devil because it has so many side effects, both short-term and long-term. It's a terrible medication to be on. And it's really not taking care of the problem. It's basically what it's doing is it's suppressing our immune system. And every time, you know, there's this underlying fire that flares up. We hit it with steroids, but we're not really getting rid of the fire. So every time we have a flare, we have to hit it with increasing amounts of steroids in order to get the same effect, which is really sad. We're really not helping anyone and really doing more harm than good. And as practitioners, that should be our goal, is not to do harm. First, do no harm. That's the oath that we all took. The other alternative are really, really strong immunosuppressants, which again have tons and tons of side effects, and again are not addressing the underlying issue. We're not talking about what's causing this fire, and that's what we really need to address. And so here we are spending billions of dollars to treat this autoimmune disease, and we're hitting it with all these expensive pharmaceutical agents that aren't doing us any good. They're treating the symptoms, they're not treating the problem, and simply removing gluten from our diet can actually alleviate so many of these symptoms, or even, you know, just such a simple intervention that is not discussed. It's very unfortunate. And you know, I can't say enough about that. So how do we strengthen our immune system? You know, so it's important to pay attention to our immune system. So how can we build our immune system and make sure that it continues to stay strong and we don't head down this horrible avenue? Because the fact of the matter is that a lot of us do have the gene, a gene for some sort of autoimmune disease. And so you shouldn't feel that we're doomed, that, oh my gosh, I have the gene, oh my mom had it, my dad had it, oh my gosh, I'm probably going to develop it. That's not the case. It's our lifestyle choices that predict whether these genes will be turned on or off. So we do have control. We have more control than a lot of people let us believe. So, food. I mean, I can't stress it enough. Anti-inflammatory foods. Making sure we're eating real whole foods. We're staying away from processed foods. Foods that our body doesn't recognize. Foods that will trigger off this whole immune response and really affect and make us sick, basically. Stress management. We all live stressful lives. We all have different stories. I listen to my patients, and I know, especially in the state of our economy these days, a lot of us are carrying multiple jobs. It's a hard life. It's a hard time, but we need to take care of ourselves. We need to address our stress, because if we don't, it will affect our immunity and in a huge way, in fact. Getting enough sleep, so important. It's when we sleep that our body is really able to rejuvenate and heal. So it's such an important time. A lot of people have a lot of type A patients who always try to cut back on their sleep because they think it's wasteful. You know, they're always wanting to do more. There's always so much time in the day. And they're the ones I put down as a goal is to get more sleep. And we try to really emphasize that because it is so critical to well-being and good health. Leaky gut, you know, it's such a predominant issue these days, and so we can heal the gut, and so, you know, working with your practitioner and discussing how to do that, it can be done, and it takes due diligence, and, you know, the rewards are tremendous. And it's amazing, I tell my patients all the time, you know, never be discouraged, it's amazing how our body works. And, you know, it's amazing how the body can even heal itself. All we can do is give a little. You know, even just making one change can make an extraordinary impact on the health. So don't ever be discouraged. You don't need to take leaps and bounds. I always say just do it one step at a time because this isn't about doing things. This isn't about a quick fix. This is about a lifestyle change. And it's about doing things slowly because then it becomes how you do things. You're not thinking about it anymore. It's just how you do it. You know, and that's what we want. Xenobiotic immunotoxicity, Dr. Lundquist talked about that. It's basically our toxic load. We're exposed to so many chemicals that are triggering our immune response. We need to be mindful of that. We need to reduce it and cut back as much as possible. And then nutritional deficiencies. In America, we are the most overfed yet undernourished nation. Because the foods that we consume are nutrient deficient, basically. even gluten, for example, it's an anti-nutrient. Not only does it trigger off an immune response, but it's also an anti-nutrient, which means that it blocks the absorption of nutrients. So if you eat a whole bunch of green leafy veggies, it's going to block the absorption of a lot of those nutrients that our body needs. And so this is a big issue. So again, think about your choices. So, you know, the marketing has, you know, I think when you walk through the grocery store, I want you to think about things a little bit different. They do, you know, anything that has a label on the front that's promoting any sort of health benefit, I probably steer away from it. Tell something shady about that. You want to really pick real foods, you know, real whole foods. And so the foods on the right are all those anti-inflammatory foods that are so good for us.
Yes, best foods to choose are ones that don't have any ingredients right along
with it. But in order to do that, I'm going to talk about certain foods,
we have that 10%. None of us are 100% perfect. You know, so
So you have that 10%. Your body is actually very forgiving. And so don't think that this is some tremendous task that you can't take on and you can't continue for the rest of your life. This is a lifestyle choice. And again, 90% of the time is do what you need to do. And you can have that conversation right now. And, you know, what they think is great. You know, yeah. So that's a great question.
You don't mind, we have a few more slides to get through, and then we'll open it up for questions. But these are great. If you don't get your questions, please ask if you don't think you do. But I just know that otherwise we'll be here all night. We got a few more slides to get through. That's a great question, so I want to give you the answer.
All right, so we're just going to summarize what we just talked about. So, again, a strong immune system is so critical to life. And autoimmune disease is when an illness occurs in which our body attacks our own healthy tissue. Autoimmune diseases are the third leading cause of morbidity, mortality in industrialized nations. There are multiple triggers, there's not just one, so we need to be mindful of that. And gluten triggers inflammation in the body, and in turn triggers our immune system to react against it. And over time, this is all a slow process, it can trigger autoimmune disease. And so conventional pharmaceuticals, which I see so many patients that go to their rheumatologist, for instance, and they're just hit with steroids or these really strong medications, and we're really not addressing the root cause, and it's heartbreaking. And of course, food is medicine. So we really need to think about what we put in our mouths because it affects us so tremendously. So this is a great proverb. It's a proverb. It's an Ayurvedic proverb. When diet is wrong, medicine is of no use. When diet is correct, medicine is of no use. All right, I'm going to pass it back to Dr. Monica. Thank you for your attention.
You can see why I'm so excited to have her here. So she's right on board with what I've been trying to do. And for those of you who haven't seen me yet and have wanted to get in to see me because I haven't been taking patients for 6 to 8 months, now you have a great alternative. So we're excited. Hopefully we'll be opening soon. So I'm going to kind of speed through these last few slides and then we'll be back again. And what we'll do is we'll you let us know, let Lindy and Devin know, but we can go into more detail of some of these disorders, these medical problems, and we can talk about really how gluten relates to them. But let's go through some of the endocrine disorders. So, you know, the issue with the endocrine disorders is really glycemic index. Okay? Raise your hand if you do not know what glycemic index is. Okay, so glycemic index is basically how quickly your blood sugar goes up when you consume a particular item. So a great example is sugar. You eat sugar, blood sugar goes up. But guess what? 2 slices of bread is equal to 2 tablespoons of sugar, of whole wheat organic bread. So you want to raise your blood sugar the same as 2 tablespoons of sugar, eat 2 slices of organic whole wheat bread. And you'll shoot your blood sugar up the same amount. Okay? That creates a problem. Your body then says, whoa, that's too much. Let me release insulin. Insulin's going to drive that blood sugar down. And when it drives it down quickly, because it went up quickly, now you get hypoglycemic. And now you feel tired. You want to go to sleep. You want to take a nap. You feel depressed. And guess what insulin does with all that sugar? It stores it as fat. Okay? So now we're getting obese, our blood sugar is starting to go bonkers, it's increasing the inflammation, and now it's producing a whole host of problems. And interestingly enough, when you eat, there's three things that basically will raise your bad cholesterol. And not just your bad cholesterol, but the small, gooey, sticky bad cholesterol particles. And that is sugar, grains, and starchy legumes. Okay, so if you go to the McDonald's and you get your french fries, you're going to have cardiovascular disease just from that one set of french fries for at least a week. In other words, those LDL particles that are created because of the french fries you ate and the inflammation you get will last in your body at least a week. It'll take that long for your body to reduce that. That creates problems. Now, if you're already at 70, 80% closed, clogged arteries, and now you have one more french fry, one more burger or something, it's going to raise that up, and now all of a sudden you're sitting at 85, 90%. Okay? Supplements aren't going to help it that much. It's food that's going to make it. Supplements are just that. They're supplements. And that's why, you know, I had a patient who basically said, I don't understand why I had a heart attack when I was taking my fish oil. I told him it was a cheeseburger he was having every day. Okay? It's food is the problem. Okay? But that's what's happening with our endocrine disorders. And when you get high levels of blood sugar, it starts to glaze your protein. Alright? Just like a donut, it's going to glaze your protein. It's called glycation. When that happens, these proteins become very inflammatory. In fact, Alzheimer's is now being called diabetes type 3 because they're finding these glycated proteins in the brain that are releasing, that are causing the brain to be stimulated to form amyloid. Amyloid is the protein that's causing these neurofibrillar tangles that's changing the way the brain functions. Okay? So if you coat your proteins in your eye, you're going to develop cataracts. If you coat the proteins in your synovium, you're going to get arthritis. If you coat the proteins in your blood vessel walls, you're going to get stiffened, thick walls, which leads to hypertension. So these are all things that are going to cause problems because of that glycation. And obviously, then, if you've got problems with your blood sugar and your cholesterol, you're going to have cardiovascular disease. So if you're eating gluten-containing products, then they're carb-loaded. And the modern wheat is really carb-loaded. It's a real big problem. You eat a piece of einkorn bread, it's heavy. It's dense. And you only want one, to be honest. But that satisfies you. It's nutrient-dense. You're going to get some gluten, and as long as you're not having gluten problems at the time, your fire department's working pretty good, that einkorn wheat bread is going to do you some good. Okay? Now, what's interesting is that Dr. Davis, how many of you have read The Wheat Belly? Okay, a few of you. So Dr. Davis is a cardiologist. He wrote a book called The Wheat Belly that will go into more detail than you ever wanted to know about the history of our wheat and about gluten and how it's just destroying the body. He does what's called coronary calcium scores, okay? That's a way of kind of predicting your likelihood of having a heart attack. They've been able to reduce coronary calcium scores within a year up to 50%. In some cases, he was even saying 80%, but most of the time, 50% by taking gluten out of the diet. Now, it's interesting. And putting them on a lower carbohydrate diet. That's tremendous. That's what Dr. Ryan was talking about when food is medicine. It's not statin therapy that's going to get that kind of result. It's changing your food. So neurological disorders are, this is really coming big. And Europe actually has tons of research now that's coming out on neurological disorders related to gluten. And they're getting published here in the United States. We talked about tissue transglutaminase in the gut, all right? Well, they found out tissue transglutaminase 6 in the brain, and it's part of the blood-brain barrier. Just like your gut tries to keep things that shouldn't be there, your brain keeps certain things out that should go into your brain. Your brain is 60% fat, And if it can't block out toxins, those toxins are going to get into the fat, and then it's going to affect the way you can think. Well, when they started testing, we now have the ability to test for these particular antibodies. They're finding that people who have neurological disorders are having, in fact, 50% or more, 57% to be exact, of patients who go in with an unknown cause of a neurological disorder will have antibodies against gluten. 57%. If we know what the cause is of the neurological disorder, 5% of them will have antibodies against gluten. And then the other thing about this is that gluteomorphins, which come from wheat and gluten, actually bind to the opioid receptor and trigger an addiction. Now, when you went gluten-free, just that first week, did you go through withdrawals? Yeah, so she's saying that her body actually felt sicker that first week. Absolutely, it's a drug. So the more that you have it, those people who are consuming 147 pounds of it are having a real problem. Okay? And it's not easy. If you go cold turkey gluten free, it's tough. That first week is hard. You're gonna have withdrawals, you're gonna be a little bit miserable. But then it gets better. It gets better. All right, Dr. Hajibasalu, say that five times, is a neurologist in the United Kingdom. This is what he says in regards to gluten and neurological disorder. Neurological manifestations of gluten sensitivity are a scientific fact, not a theological issue. The debate continues. We owe it to our patients to screen them effectively for gluten sensitivity with the widely available anti-gliadin antibody test, so that we do not in the meantime deprive them of a harmless but potentially effective treatment in the form of a gluten-free diet. I will tell you, it's not hard to pick up those patients who have a gluten sensitivity. What's hard is convincing them that they have a gluten sensitivity problem. That's where labs come in. All right? Labs are not for me, really, but for you as patients. All right, because sometimes you need that staring you back in the face. Okay, I will do this. I really need to do this. All right, so Alzheimer's is something that we talked about a little bit. 54% of current Alzheimer's patients could have been prevented if lifestyle measures would have been addressed. 54%. Okay, when you get diagnosed with Alzheimer's, right now we have no way of reversing it. Okay, now the brain is pretty plastic, we're finding. Actually, you can do a lot to enhance and help the brain if you're having problems, but Alzheimer's is one that we haven't figured out how to reverse. So the only way to prevent Alzheimer's is to prevent Alzheimer's. That's the only way to treat it. They found when they looked at hemoglobin A1C, which is a glycolated protein in the blood, and that's actually what we use to monitor diabetes. So you've heard that term before. It's a measurement. It takes 3 months before you get changes because it takes that long for your red blood cells to recycle. In elevations as low as 5.4%. Okay, now we're talking diabetes isn't diagnosed until 6.5%. You're considered under good control if you're at 6.5%. We don't consider you out of control until you're above 7.5%. We're talking 5.4%. They're already seeing shrinkage in the hippocampus of the brain, which is the part where you have memory problems. Okay? Small amounts of blood sugar change. 5.4%. We don't even call pre-diabetes until they're 5.6%. So where should you be? You should be less than 5.3%. Right, but gluten is going to cause that. Headaches, all right? So this isn't a first visit to a neurologist, all right? A patient shows up and says, you know, I've been everywhere. I can't get a resolution for my headaches. I've been tried on these medications. And they show up in the neurologist's office, and they test them for gluten. Not very many neurologists are doing that. All right. But this came out in April of 2013. This is fresh off the press. All right. 14% did not have a gluten sensitivity. Only 14%. The rest of them had problems with gluten. All right. Of those, 30% had antibodies consistent with celiac disease. That's huge. And then what they're finding is that now some of these, like it's easier to fix a leaky gut than it is to fix a leaky brain. And it may take up to 9 months before we start seeing symptom improvement in some of the neurological disorders. So as a doctor, you know, do I really want to just sit around and say, well, maybe gluten's the problem, but let's try some other things first. I'm reaching for gluten right away. Why wait? Really, the problem is convincing my patients that they need to be gluten-free. But it's amazing. It's amazing what happens. In autism, this was a study done at Columbia University. 24% of autistic children tested positive for IgG antibodies to gliadin. Okay? Autism went from being 1 in 1,000, 1 in 2,000, 1 in 10,000, to now being 1 in 100. Because we're just that much better at diagnosing? Not really. It's just increasing. In fact, here's California's rates. Up to 2003. And guess when they introduced GMO? It does. So, 1996. Yes. Yeah. So the comment and the question is that several people have come into So Good Gluten Free, and their kids are autistic, and the mothers were diagnosed with an autoimmune thyroid disorder during pregnancy, or before pregnancy, or after pregnancy, and there's so the question is there a correlation between, and we don't know. We don't have studies that show that, at least that I've seen. However, based upon the information you've seen tonight, there's probably a link. All right? Now, autism is one of those neurological disorders that we're still trying to figure out. But what we're finding out is that it's a nutritional deficiency problem. When you correct with the right nutrition, you see significant improvements in autistic behavior, and if you get there early enough, you can make a huge impact. Because the brain, like, it's plastic. I mean, it's going to change. It's going to grow and develop. And if we can start healing the brain, it may take 9 months after we remove these things, but kids are going to respond a lot quicker than the adults. Okay, so here's what I do for treatment for the gut. All right, and basically I remove offending agents and get those out, and if we have to knock down your bacterial overgrowth, your candida overgrowth, we use antibiotics or antifungals to do that, or herbs that may help in that, and then we'll replace nutrients and acid and other things that may be contributing to the problem, maybe enzymes, pancreatic enzymes to help improve digestion. And then we're going to put good bacteria. One of the things that we're finding out as far as the immune system goes is that we need that bacteria in our gut to balance our immune system. When it starts to get out of balance, our immune system gets out of balance. So taking probiotics, high-dose probiotics, can be really helpful. And then repairing the gut. And there's certain things that are really good at repairing the gut. One of my favorites is L-glutamine, aloe vera, things like that. And I thought Rosa did a great job of talking about rebalancing our lives and stress management. All right, so the first question is, why not, can I just eat organic? Is that enough? Why do I need to go gluten-free? Well, the problem is that even organic gluten modern wheat is going to be a problem. And a third of people have the genetics that are going to make that a lot harder fire to put out. And those who do, anybody that I, my opinion is anybody that comes in with an autoimmune disorder, diabetes, headaches, some kind of health problem, I'm putting them on a gluten-free diet. Why not? And we're lucky. Rosie was telling me in Florida, where she came from, I mean, we have three gluten-free bakeries within a 10-mile radius. She's like, I don't even know if we have a gluten-free bakery in the whole state of Florida. So it's a big difference. We're lucky. And the reason we have these things is because you guys are determining with your dollars. You know, they're able to stay in business because you guys come here. So that's what changes. But it's really important to get the right kind of diet. That's why I pull the things out of it. Like, we got to fix the gut. The gut's one of the primary things to do. Yeah. So some of the gluten-free breads, there's only a few things on the glycemic index that are higher than sugar. Whole wheat's one of them. Tapioca starch is another. And there's one other gluten-free product that I'm forgetting which one that is. No, it was maybe potato starch. And it's the starches. So it's, again, it's the extract, the carbohydrate extract from these things that are the problem. And so, again, you know, gluten-free junk food is still junk food. It may not cause as much inflammation, but if there's a lot of sugar in there. So, I mean, one of the things that I really appreciate about what they do here is that they try and use organic, whole plant foods to make things. And they use lower glycemic sugars when they can. But sometimes in order to make it taste good, yeah. So, okay, so that donut that I may get here that's gluten-free may be so inflammatory. So I better not be having one every day for breakfast. Yeah, so he mentioned that he's using agave as a low glycemic sweetener. And true agave is, the problem is there's a lot of agaves being put on the market. They're mixing it with corn syrup. There's no regulations. They can say this is agave syrup, and it can be 50% agave and 50% corn syrup. So if you buy organic agave, then you know for sure. But I'm telling you, you buy organic agave, it's expensive. So just be careful. Facebook page this past week saw Truly was made with genetically modified. Then they fed the Truvia to fruit flies and killed in a week. So again, you want to use organic whole extract or use the Rebbiano leaf, which is the stevia leaf, so that you're in it. I'm telling you, if you got true stevia, it's got an aftertaste. You're not getting this tea is sugar, all right? And they're adding things to it that are going to make it up. It was xylitol, that's what it was. The xylitol that they were using came from a genetically modified source. Yes. So the question is about frozen fruits and vegetables. Unless it says organic, you can't be guaranteed. Right? They're just freezing it. They're just freezing it and then putting it in. And that's a great way of buying vegetables. Yeah, you can get. Yeah, the other thing is, how many of you know about community supported agriculture or CSA? All right, so one of the best ways to get organic fruit and vegetables here in our community is through